Well, good morning, everyone. And it's lovely to meet on a bright, sunny morning. We've had lots of rain. Our thoughts and prayers are with our farming community at this time. But it's nice to meet at the beginning of the Lord's Day with the sun shining and to celebrate the rising sun as we do week by week. Just to mention a couple of the announcements, do read through the announcements on the sheet. But this evening is the annual Men's Reach service in Scott Street at 6:30. There will be a cup of tea after that service in the main hall. And I think David's just going to come maybe and share a bit about the service and about some open days that there will be in the Men's Reach premises. Yeah, I think those mics are working if you want to just use them.
Good morning. Men's Reach has now been going for 2 years. And if you're someone who has either taken part in the activities or someone who has prayed for the activities, please come along this evening to our service. The service, the theme of the service is growth. And we'll be talking a bit about the groups that are meeting to study God's word together, the groups that are meeting for a bit of physical and social activity, but also talking about where we're hoping to go in the future. There's going to be some very interesting interviews, and Philip Boyd will be bringing God's word to us this evening. As part of that growth, we're running two open days on Tuesday and Thursday of this week. So slightly earlier than our usual time of 10:30, we're starting at 10 o'clock in the town park for a walk in the park on Tuesday morning. For those who don't want to go for a walk, there will be other activities available, board games and some outdoor stuff, provided the weather's good enough. And on Thursday, we'll be running the walking football at the Swifts from 10 o'clock as well. There will be refreshments at both activities. If you've been praying for us, or if you're wondering should be you be sending your husband along to these activities, please come along and see what we've been doing. We'd really love to have you. And as I say, both start Tuesday and Thursday, start at 10 o'clock in the morning, and really open to everyone to come along and see what we're at. Thank you very much.
Just to say that there's no meeting of the circle this evening. The Noah's Ark Stay and Play resumes this week, and then on Tuesday evening, the PW are going to Major's Pantry for a fellowship and meal, and you're asked to be there for 7 o'clock on Tuesday evening. The Wednesday morning Bible study is meeting, but there's no midweek Bible study this coming Wednesday. It will resume on Wednesday week, the 24th, when we'll be looking at Roger Carswell's little book, Who is Jesus?, that was given out at the Easter praise evening. And there are still some copies there if you want to take it, read it and come along, and we'll be just considering that book that evening. Then on Thursday evening, the missionary committee meets at 7:30 in the church office. And then next Sunday morning is our annual open door service, and there will be a retiring offering at that service for the work of open doors. You'll see there are a number of important meetings and events coming over the next few weeks. Please do take note of them. We worship God together. I want over a few Sundays to just look at what I'm calling post-resurrection encounters with Jesus. And this morning we're thinking about a heart-warming experience. The psalmist says, "My heart grew hot within me while I meditated, the fire burned." We have a wonderful picture in Revelation of what heaven will be like, how there will be a great multitude like the roar of rushing waters and like loud peals of thunder shouting, "Hallelujah, for the Lord our God reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him the glory." And that's what we do when we meet together in worship. We rejoice and are glad and give to our God the glory. We turn our eyes upon Jesus, and we're going to sing together. And can I thank Laura and the praise group, as always, when they lead our worship. We're going to sing together Isaac Watts' lovely hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." And at the end of it, we remain standing for the dedication of our offering. Let's praise God together. Father, when we think about such love, we realize that we must give you our all. We give ourselves as living sacrifices, and as a token of that giving of ourselves, we bring to you these our gifts, praying that you would use them for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's unite together in prayer. Let us pray. Our God, we worship you with joy and hope in our hearts this morning, conscious of your almighty power and constant presence and tender compassion. You know all about us. You know even the sinful ways we let you down, and yet we are assured of your unconditional love for us when we turn to you in repentance and faith. What a wonderfully good God you are. And we rejoice in your perfect love, that love we have sung about, the love of Calvary. What we could never earn, your perfect righteousness, you have credited it to us as a gift. What we could never imagine that you would receive ungodly people like us, you do so joyfully. All our sins are forgiven, covered over, and you will never hold us guilty for any of them. And we rejoice in the one in whom all the fullness of your glory dwells, who suffered and died but rose again, Jesus, Prince and Savior. And we know that our love for you is not what it ought to be, how poor it is. Lord, remind us again and again of the depth of your love for us, that we may be faithful to your every command in all our thoughts and words and deeds. You know where we struggle the most and trust you the least. You know where we succumb to temptation. Be our helper now and for always, and grant us grace and mercy and wisdom that we need day by day. And these things we ask in and through Jesus Christ, the living Lord. Amen. Our reading this morning is found in Luke's Gospel, chapter 24. As I said, I want us to look at just a couple of post-resurrection encounters. And Thomas is going to read it for us. Good man. I think you need a step up, don't you?
Cheers.
All right, good man.
On the road to Emmaus. Now that same day, the two of them were going to the village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked them, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened here in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth." They replied, "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death. and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions, but him they did not see. He said to them, "How foolish you all are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses, all of the prophets, he explained to them what was said in plan to them, all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if they were going further, but they urged him to stay strongly. Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us?" He talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us. They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them, assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Amen.
Well done, Thomas. Yeah. Thomas, you don't even have to walk far back. You just sit there at the front. And if the other boys and girls want to come up to the front, I'll come down and speak to you.
Right.
Now, I want to ask you a question. Maybe I haven't switched on. That would help, wouldn't it? Maybe I need to be switched on too. There. Do you ever, you have a warm feeling inside? I'll tell you what I mean. Maybe your teacher in school says to you, "You did really well in your spellings today." And you feel like a warm feeling inside, isn't that right? Why? Because you're happy. It's good news. Or maybe mummy says, "I'm going to make you your favorite tea tonight." What would that be, Charlie? What do you like most? Do you like baked beans? No?
Yum.
There you see. Look, that would be ideal for Emily's. Yes? Oh, I see. Right. Right. But listen, imagine. Oh, Mummy says, "I'm going to make your favorite tea." And you have that warm feeling. It's you're happy inside. Sometimes we get that warm feeling, don't we? And we're happy. I want to tell you about two men that Thomas read so well about a moment ago. And they had a warm feeling inside, but not at first. They were walking along. They were very sad. Why do you think the two men were sad as they walked home to Emmaus? Why were they sad, Thomas?
Because
Jesus had died, exactly. They were followers of Jesus, but they were very sad and they were going along. And then someone joined them on the way back. Who was it?
Jesus.
Exactly. Jesus came along, but we don't know why. They didn't know it was Jesus. They didn't know it was Jesus. They thought he was dead. They didn't know he was alive. And he began to talk to them. And he began to talk to them from the Bible. And you know what they said? Did not, when he spoke to us, were not our hearts burning within us as he opened up the Bible? They had that warm feeling inside. They were happy. And why were they happy, do you think? Because Jesus is alive. They find that Jesus wasn't dead. He's alive. And of course, we know that he's alive, don't we? And that's what we've been celebrating at Easter time, that Jesus is alive. And that's a wonderful thing to know that Jesus is a living Savior. And he wants to give us joy. He wants to give us that warm feeling because we know he's alive. And if we want joy, real joy, wonderful joy, it comes when we have Jesus, the living Jesus, living in us, and we live for him. So boys and girls, I hope that you will know that warm feeling because you know that Jesus is your Savior and friend, and you're living for him. Now we're going to sing a song. It's a new one to me. I think I was listening to it earlier. It's quite an easy one to pick up. I'll maybe get Laura, if she's able to play over again. I call things Jesus Strong and Kind. I think that right? But I'll get Laura maybe to play over the verse and the chorus for us and the praise group to sing, and then we'll join together. So if you want to go back to your seats, boys and girls. All right. Good man.
Thank you.
I said, that was a new piece to me, but it's a lovely piece. And I'm sure we'll sing it again at some point. Now I think John's going to come and lead us in our prayers of intercession.
Let us pray. Our God and Father, we come in intercession and we consider your character in that you are wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth. Father, you know all about us, our concerns, every worry, our joyful times and our sad times. Those things and sometimes even people who frustrate us. Father, forgive us our sins and guide us by your Holy Spirit so that our prayer in your will may be more effective and God-honoring. Father, we pray for our own needs, the needs of our families, the church family, our community, and the world. Lord, strengthen our faith and grow our reliance on you, remembering in all things your faithfulness. Lord, we pray for the needs in our families, whether in relationships, tensions in work, or lack of work, or lack of love of you. Lord, we thank you for our church family, and pray that you would bind us together in love for you and love for each other. Father, we remember those recently bereaved, those with health concerns, those going through treatments, those recovering their health, and for carers. Lord, may each experience your comfort as only you can bless. Father, we pray for the community into which you have placed us. May we live out our Christian faith so that others are attracted to Jesus. Father, when we consider the world, the need in Ukraine, in Israel and Gaza, in Sudan, and not to only name a few, the impact of global warming and famine suffered by millions, Father, what can we pray but that your sovereign will be done? Lord, bless your church globally and us as part of it. Keep us faithful. Keep us praising. Keep us praying. Keep us following Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Father, we humbly pray all in his saving name. Amen.
Thank you, John. As we come to look at God's word, John was reminding us in the prayer there about the goodness of God and how we should acknowledge that. We're going to sing now about the goodness of God.
Thank you.
let's pray together. Lord, we do indeed praise you for what a good God you are. As we come to look at your word, remind us of the change that you can bring, the goodness that we can know, the joy and the hope that we can have in the risen Lord Jesus. In whose name we pray. Amen. In the run-up to Easter, we were turning our eyes upon Jesus as he turned his eyes towards Jerusalem and the cross. And then on Easter Sunday, we turned our eyes upon Jesus as we turned our eyes to the empty tomb. And as I said earlier, I just want, over a couple of Sundays, to look at just two post-resurrection encounters that people had with the risen Lord Jesus Christ. And the first one is, as Thomas read for us earlier, the experience of those two men making their way home, the 7-mile journey from Jerusalem to Emmaus. A heartwarming experience. Not that their hearts were in any way warmed, as we were thinking with the boys and girls, as they began that journey. Far from it, their hearts were heavy. They were in the doldrums. As they made that 7-mile journey, they were talking with each other about everything that had happened. In other words, they were going over in their minds and talking together about all that had taken place in Jerusalem in the past few days. How their Lord had been put to death, nailed to a cross. And then these strange rumors and about finding the tomb empty. Angels declaring that Jesus was alive. And they were finding it hard to make any sense of it all. To get their heads round what was going on. They couldn't put it together and come up with any sensible explanation. So as they made their way back, they were full of confusion. They were in despair. But Jesus, as they made their way back, as they talked and discussed these things with each other, we're told Jesus came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. We don't know why. Doesn't really matter, but for some reason they weren't aware that it was their Lord. They weren't expecting to find Jesus alive. And so this stranger joined them on their journey as they walked along discussing what had been happening. And Jesus did what every person should do. He opened up a conversation. He asked a question. The most obvious question. What are you discussing as you walk along? It wasn't that Jesus didn't know. He knew fine well what they were talking about, as he knows all things, but he wanted to engage with them. He wanted to arouse their interest. He wanted to draw them out. And he wanted to give them full opportunity to unburden their hearts. And he wanted full opportunity to address their confusion and despair. The first thing we notice is that they were sad. We've already touched on that. You know, they, They stood still when Jesus asked the question. Their faces downcast, and they said, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that have happened in these days?" You know, they were sad as they went over all the events about what had taken place and shared them with this stranger. You know, about Jesus of Nazareth. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. Isn't there an irony here? They were talking about Jesus to Jesus and they didn't even realize it. But there are three words that I think sum up how they felt. We had hoped. We had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. They were looking to Jesus as God's deliverer, but now he was dead. Their despairing words, we had hoped, spoke of disillusionment, shattered dreams. They had looked to Jesus as possibly the Messiah, God's promised deliverer. But now, all hope had died and were buried with a dead Christ, so they thought. So they were dejected, they were disappointed, they were sad, full of confusion, bewilderment, depressed. Was Jesus a failure? Why had he to die? What was going to happen to the nation? And so it was with sad and heavy hearts and feet that they trudged that journey back to their home in Emmaus. We had hoped, but now their hopes had been shattered. Sad. And I think that's how many people feel as we look at our world today. Hope is gone. Wars and rumors of wars. Stabbings in a shopping mall. Murders taking place. A husband killing his wife. What's the world come to? People are disillusioned. There's hopeless despair. And we're looking for something. We are looking for something that will warm our hearts, that will give us hope. Sad. But the second S word is that they were slow. That's what Jesus said to them. How foolish you are and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. What Jesus was saying is, look, the evidence is available to you. Jesus had spoken about something significant happening 3 days after he was put to death. There have been these reports of witnesses of an empty tomb, the angel's message about Jesus being alive. The evidence was there. But they were lacking in faith. They were slow of heart to believe. O ye of little faith. The proof was there. Evidence that demands a verdict. But the problem was that they simply couldn't see Jesus. They couldn't see that he was there with them, and they couldn't see Jesus in the midst of their despair. Because they didn't believe all that the prophets had spoken. Their picture of the Messiah, God's deliverer, was still one of some conquering hero who would oust the Romans. They didn't see him as the Lord's suffering servant, pierced for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. And I wonder, are we guilty at times of not taking in all that the scriptures say? If we're to make any sense of God's word, then we need to realize that it is the whole counsel of God. If we're to get the full picture, we need to remember that all scripture is God-breathed and is of instruction and rebuke and correction to us. So what did Jesus do? He engaged in an extensive Bible study with those two men as they trampled along that dusty road. And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. It's wonderful to come on a Wednesday night to the midweek here. All due respect to Adrian and others who lead it. How much better if it is the greatest teacher explaining the greatest news from the greatest book? Just imagine Jesus leading the Bible study. All the scriptures concerning himself. You see, the key to unlocking the scriptures is that we see Christ on every page. I always remember a phrase that I learned too long ago in North Belfast Crusader class. And the leader, Connie Haddock, used to always say, "Remember, fellas, the new is in the old contained, and the Old Testament is in the new explained." It's one book. Even though it's 66 books, it's one story. And it all points to the goodness of God that we were singing about. Jesus opened up the scriptures to them. They were slow. And I wonder at times, are we just like those two disciples going to a mess? How foolish are we? How slow of heart to believe? We need to get faith. We need to trust and obey. They were sad. They were slow. But they were satisfied in the end. As Jesus opened up God's word to them, you know, something began to click. You know, He triggered their interest. There was something about this stranger and the way he spoke and what he spoke about. And they wanted to know more. They still didn't realize who it was, but they said, you know, stay with us. It's almost evening. The day is almost over. Come on, let's have a meal together. And they sat down. Jesus had opened the scriptures to them, and now he began to open their eyes to himself. And how did it come about? When they sat down for that meal, when they were at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and began to give it to them. It probably reminded them of another time when bread was broken. And they began to realize who it was. Maybe as he broke the bread, they were able to see the nail marks in the wrists. Or maybe it was simply the moment that God chose to, as it were, take the scales away and make it clear that here was his son, the living Lord Jesus, their master. But now they recognized him. Their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he was gone. He disappeared from their sight. But now, those who were slow of faith had the eyes of faith, and they could see and know the Savior. And what did they say? Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened up the scriptures to us? It was a heartwarming experience for them to meet the living Lord Jesus. It changed their lives. Their hearts were stirred and hope was restored. They had that warm inner feeling that I was talking about earlier, because their Lord was alive. A heartwarming experience. In May 1728, John Wesley wrote in his journal, "I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ alone for salvation, and an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. I felt my heart strangely warmed." Because Christ, he encountered Christ, the risen Lord Jesus Christ, who gives purpose to our confused minds and direction to our misguided lives, who turns darkness into light and takes away sorrow and fear and gives us hope. One other S, and that is share. Because what did those two men do? They got up, returned at once to Jerusalem, and they were virtually home. They had to go all the way back again, another 7 miles. And there they find the 11 and those with them assembled together and said, "It's true, the Lord is risen." They had to tell others. They had to share their heartwarming experience, their encounter with Christ. And that's what we're called to do, to share with others what he has done. Because it is a heartwarming experience to encounter the living Lord Jesus Christ. Because it restores our hope. And it's all summed up in those wonderful words at the beginning of Peter's first letter. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." New birth into a living hope. That's a heartwarming experience, isn't it? And I trust that each one of us will have that encounter with the risen Christ and discover that new birth that he brings, that new life, a living hope in a living Savior. Let's pray together. Father, we pray that you would open our eyes as the eyes of those two men going to Emmaus were opened. that we may recognize Jesus for who he is. And may our hearts be strangely warmed as God's word comes alive through a living Savior. Lord, may we each encounter Christ and find the hope that he brings. And we pray these things in his precious name. Amen. We're going to close by singing a lovely old hymn that just reminds us of that personal relationship, that encounter with Christ. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. If ever I loved thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. May this be a moment for us, Lord. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, and the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be ours now and forevermore. Amen.